I started out in Florida, producing a record at a studio, and I got friendly with the engineer and got interested in engineering. Next thing I knew, I was listening to an album called Freak Out by the Mothers of Invention. I became very interested in their concept of music, their concept of society in general, and their concept of humor, which I thought was very good and enjoyed because they were saying a whole bunch of stuff that I wanted to say, and I agreed with and thought was true. Then one day I decided I'll move to New York because the air is clean and the people are friendly and everybody's in love. So I went to New York and I got this job at this incredible 12-track studio. Well, I didn't know from 12-track. I thought 4-track was really hot stuff. So I went in there and they said, "Here's the board, learn it. You got your first client's coming in 5 minutes." Well, my first client was Frank Zappa.
Sports fans. And now, ladies and gentlemen,
what I'm saying is that honesty is the best policy. And honesty in all forms of American business is totally down the tubes right now. It's its lowest ebb in history.
How do you get it back?
Well, first of all, you have to create a desire for it to be there. And when you have political leaders who do not demonstrate honesty, when you have people lying to you constantly on television, on the radio, in the movies, it's all a lie, and everybody just gets used to the lie as a way of life, then honesty as a concept is very outmoded and archaic, and nobody wants to be an honest guy anymore, because if you're honest, then you're going to finish last, you know, the good guy's finishing last. And this is bad. I just think that it's disgusting. I'm 40 years old. I remember when there used to be a little honesty around.
What, don't you think there still is? I mean, don't you think?
Not
I mean, don't you
dangerous.
Consider yourself an honest person?
Yeah, but I'm not in a position where I can do anything to influence anybody.
And don't you think there are honest people who are in some of those other areas? You mentioned politics, you mentioned movies, you mentioned television, the media.
There's always exceptions to the rule, but I would say, and without batting an eye, that the rule today is dishonesty is the rule and honesty is the exception.
See, I would hate to believe that.
You can hate to believe it, but if you don't believe it, you're a fool.
Hi, boys and girls. I'm Jimmy Carl Black. I'm the Indian of the group.
If you're talking strictly about quantity of people being honest versus quantity of people being dishonest, maybe you could come up with a statistic balance that would show that maybe 51 or 52% of the people are honest and 48 are shady. But the few that really control things are not honest, and they count for more votes than the extra ones who might be honest. Do you know what I mean?
I know what you're saying, but who would those people be?
I don't think we have an honest president. I don't think that he is surrounded by honest people. I don't think that most of the people in Congress or in the Senate are honest. I don't believe that they are honest people.
And why do you say that? What makes you believe that?
I think the proof of that is the way the country operates. And I don't think that most of the people who head up businesses are honest.
See, I would hate to feel that negative. I mean, I realize that unless you open your eyes to a situation as it really is, you can't do anything about changing it. But I would hate to be that negative, that pessimistic about the shape of this country and the shape of the people in this country.
You would hate to be that negative and be right.
Yes.
That's what would really be horrible. Now, if you could be that negative and somebody would suddenly just come up with all the proof and say, it's really okay, you're just a negative kind of a person. You know, that would be like a cute little dream for a minute there. But I believe that I'm right. I believe they are dishonest. I believe we have allowed them to be the way that they are. We have voted them in. We got them in there, and we're letting them do it. Because we're not honest enough to face up to the fact that we are owned and operated by a bunch of really bad people.
All right, then let's just say that what you're saying is true. I don't totally agree with it, but let's say it is true.
That's all right. You're a nice person, so you don't...
All right, thank you. My mother thanks you. Let's say it is true. What do honest people do to change it?
I don't know whether they can. That's what really sounds pessimistic.
Yes, it does.
I don't know.
Fatalistic, almost.
No, it's not fatalistic. I mean, you can try, but I don't know whether or not the effort will yield results.
What do you do? I mean, if you are feeling all of these things, how are you able to get out of bed the next day if you are feeling that things are this bad in this country?
Well, I do what I do because I love to do it. I'm dedicated to music, and I get up and I do my music, and I do it my way, and I try not to compromise. Mm-hmm. And if I get a chance to go on television and say this, then I do that too.
Yes.
And other than that, what else can I do? I'm not about to march around the street with a sign in my hand. That doesn't do anything. But you can remind people that something's wrong, because the tendency today is to just gloss over it. The desire for escapist activities is really at quite a peak now. And media likes to accommodate that desire. And the more you can escape from how horrible things really are, the less it's going to bother you, and then the worse things get.
upset stomach, I'll give you some Pepto-Dismal.
Tell me about some of the different things that happened in high school.
Well, I managed to graduate with about 20 units less than what you were supposed to have because I'd been thrown out so many times. And one of the reasons why I was thrown out is because when I was a senior in high school and my younger brother was a freshman, he was kind of sexually assaulted by one of the shop teachers during a class. And I found out about this during the break between classes and immediately went over there and held this particular shop teacher at bay with a wood-turning chisel and a pair of tin snips and, you know, did blackboard jungle on this guy and until the dean of men came in and took me away. You know, but I don't like to stand for people pushing me around and pushing my relatives around, you know, and I get very upset about things like that.
Thank you.
think that the situation that we have right now is a cartoon president who is an actor. The guy is an actor. They should have given him an Academy Award and let it go at that.
Is that a bad thing to be an actor? Can't an actor have a mind?
If you are an actor and you want to act, go do it. If you're an actor and you want to be the president of the United States, have something going for you more than your acting ability. I don't believe he has the intellectual substance to back up what he says, because his lines are manufactured for him. He is surrounded by people who feed him information, not all of it good, in fact, most of it bad. And he sits there and acts it out. He's reading the teleprompter. He's a teleprompter president. You take that support team away from him, he's hollow. He's got nothing going for him. He's a smiling, nice guy. He's a nice cowboy guy. Mm-hmm. All right? Is this what we deserved? You know, if you're an actor and you know something about foreign policy, and you know something about economics, and you know something about the military, and you know something about something other than being phony, which is what actors get paid to do, to pretend, okay? Mm-hmm. If you are equipped, go be the president. I don't think he's equipped. The only thing he's got is friends in high places, friends with money, and people who feed him stuff to say. I mean, let's be honest about it.
And a lot of people don't share those views. They're wrong.
That's my view. I think they're wrong. They're being duped. You know, the emperor is not wearing any clothes. The guy's got nothing to offer. He waves. He smiles nice. He's a nice guy, okay? Mm-hmm. I don't hate him. I just think he's not equipped to be the president. He was elected by 17% of the population in an election where the people were offered a choice between Tweedledum and Tweedledee, you know, and Tweedledee got it.
Some of you might not agree, but you probably likes a lot of misery. But think a while and you will see.
Say that remark about the unions, and in the context in which you use it, you said the unions that come in to ruin.
They do ruin it. Absolutely. I think that that's one of the worst things that's happened to America today, is the way in which unions of all descriptions have affected the quality of life in the United States. And the way that unions are represented on television and the PR organizations that they pay and that they have going for them try and perpetuate the myth that America is a unionized country, and when something wrong happens, the unions are there to sort of fight for that underdog working guy. And maybe in the beginning, when there was a certain type of oppression in the workplace, the unions did come in and help support the viewpoint of the working underdog. But what they have turned into is these vast organizations that take money from poor working guys, invest it in shady deals, and don't really help the working people, while still feeding them these fantasies that if you all stop working and go on a strike, then we'll be able to get more money for you in your paycheck. But all that does is make the guy that they're working for raise the price of the goods that he's manufacturing, and then everybody else bites the bag. But in the case of the arts, I see situations all the time where stagehands unions are paid incredible amounts of money for doing nothing, and in many instances degrading the quality of the live shows that they're associated with. I see people who are in executive positions in unions thinking up regulations that don't really fit with the way the craft is being run, like in the musicians union, for instance, in certain aspects of the television business.
And you're a member of the musicians union.
I am a member of the musicians union, and it makes me feel kind of strange to have to say bad things about a union that I belong to, but I'm forced to join that union because of the way the business operates, and I'm forced to do business with other unions as I travel around and play live shows. But that does not mean that I should keep my mouth shut about the way that they operate. Many of them operate by extortion, and they subject the touring groups to regulations that are ridiculous.
You want to hear a sad story before we begin? This is really tragic. It breaks my heart because it shows me the direction that America has gone in recently. We wanted to record these shows here at this hall. And we brought the equipment with us to record the shows at this hall. And the shows that we are going to play at this hall will be excellent. And they should be on the record. But no, they won't be recorded. You know why? Because the union that operates this hall wanted me to pay between $3,500 and $5,000 just for the privilege of recording in this hall. Now that's really stupid. Now, I don't think that's fair, and I hope that one day that the union that operates this hall finds out why that is a bad policy. Because if recordings get made in halls like this, it's going to be better business for everybody all the way around. And I think they should reassess their policy. Ooh, contestant number one.
You say many of them result to in extortion. What do you mean by that?
Well, let's say you want to go to a place and you want to do a live recording at a hall. A guy from the union will come up to you in some places and say, you can't turn your recording equipment on unless you pay us, say, $3,000. And you say, for what? Oh, for extra union fees. For what? Oh, because we have to pay this special rate for these men who are standing around here. Well, for what? Well, that's just what the union says. And if you don't pay, we'll stop the show.
Would they do that?
Oh, yeah. Sure they would.
Have you paid?
Some instances, if I think the show is important enough to record and there is no recourse, I will pay. Other instances, I don't pay and I don't record. And this happened to us last year in Chicago when we were working there. They wanted to stick us with a $3,000 bill. I mean, the workmen who are at the hall are doing no extra work. I supply all the labor for this recording because it's my recording equipment. I supply all the equipment and the manpower. Why should I have to pay an extra fee to a bunch of guys who are sitting around who care nothing about what I'm doing, will do nothing to help the quality of it, or not putting in an extra second of work or an extra ounce of muscle power? Why should I be bribing them?
Hey, hey, hey,
you know we gotta stick together.
We gotta stick together.
You
trying to tell me that this whole universe revolves around one note?
No, it doesn't revolve around it. That's what it is. It's one note. Everybody knows that the lights are notes. Light is just a vibration of a note, too. Everything is.
What makes you really angry?
The thing that makes me really angry is the exaltation of ignorance. That really makes me mad.
Mm-hmm.
Now, I was telling another person a little while ago that people have thought that hydrogen was the basic building block of the universe because it's so prevalent. Mm-hmm. But I believe that the basic building block of the universe is stupidity. Now, stupidity has a lot of charm to it, but ignorance doesn't.
Isn't ignorance bliss?
No, I wouldn't say so. Never having been truly ignorant, I couldn't tell you about
really
a blissful state like that. And I've observed a lot of other people who are ignorant, and I wouldn't say that they were in a state of bliss either. They were okay. They were having a good time. I wouldn't call it bliss.
Why does it make you angry, and what can you do about that anger? How can you change it?
Well, I can't change it, you know, but that doesn't keep me from being angry about it.
Mm-hmm. And in what ways are people ignorant, and how should they change?
Remember, I said the thing that makes me mad is the exaltation of ignorance.
Yes,
you know, when you celebrate ignorance, you know, and make that the national standard.
How is it celebrated?
It's celebrated in all records that achieve massive airplay on the radio, all television sitcoms, most films, and most commercials. And also in schools.
How in schools?
Schools train people to be ignorant with style. They give you the equipment that you need to be a functional ignoramus. American schools do not equip you to deal with things like logic. They don't give you the criteria by which to judge between good and bad in any medium or format. And they prepare you to be a usable victim for a military-industrial complex that needs manpower. As long as you're just smart enough to do a job and just dumb enough to swallow what they feed you, you're going to be all right. But if you go beyond that, you're going to have these grave doubts that give you stomach problems, headaches, make you want to go out and do something else. So I believe that schools mechanically and very specifically try and breed out any hint of creative thought and the kids that are coming up. And when I see the pathetic solutions that are being offered by this regime to the problems facing the United States, economic and otherwise, I get very angry because they're the wrong solutions. You know how to solve the economic crisis? Tax the churches. Tax the churches and all the businesses that they own and tax them all the way back to their inception. They should pay their fair share of what it costs to run the country. You tax the churches, you won't have to take the food off the dish of the school lunches. There's plenty of money there. They're making plenty of money. Tax them. Nobody in government is going to stand up and say that, and it's the most common sense solution to the economic problem. There's plenty of money owed by those organizations who claim to be religious and who are actually in the real estate business. They're in the supermarket business. They're in the chocolate business. They're in a lot of businesses above and beyond helping people to get to heaven.
Mm-hmm.
And these are all very temporal businesses, and they should be taxed the same as the guy who owns a gas station.
Have you called up a television station or written to a film company and said, I really like this. This is good stuff.
Well, you'd be surprised. I've actually done that a couple of times.
Uh-huh.
In fact, one time, there was a television evangelist in Los Angeles. I don't think he's located there, but he's broadcast there. He's on Channel 20, and he's on all the time. He's on 36 hours a day. I can't remember his name. He's got white hair. And he sits there, and he's a real fundamentalist, and he's, you know, he's hard sell. And I watch these shows a lot, all the different ones. And I listened to him for one night for about 2 hours, and I thought he was brilliant. And I called up, and I said so. You know,
yes.
Because what he was talking about at that time, he sounded like one of the smartest lawyers I've ever seen in my life. As long as he was talking about something that was realistic. you know, other than his monetary pitch for his organization. I could definitely be enthusiastic about what he was doing. And I called up and said so.
You are certainly, I can't call you conservative, and would never do that, but in many ways you are reflecting conservative points of view as far as raising your children, as far as the way you discipline them.
There's nothing wrong with that, though. I mean, you know, like, just because I'm in the rock and roll industry, okay, I have certain views that I think are traditional, whether you call them conservative or whatever. That's just the way
I feel about it.
Today, conservative has turned into a really disgusting word because all the different kinds of people who claim to be conservative aren't really. They're fanatic. They're not conservative. They're fanatic. The way the word is being used today is real wrong because most of the people who are screaming that they're conservative are really just fanatics. And this moral majority religious syndrome, not just to single out the moral majority as one entity, but it is the one that people normally look at. There are a lot of other ones, a lot of other companies in the television religious business that are functioning today that claim to be conservative but are really fanatic. They're as fanatic as the Muslim sects that are causing all the problems in the Middle East. They're dangerous and they're wrong.
But in this country, now see, that's your opinion, all right? And you have stated it.
That's right.
Okay. You have the freedom in this country to state your opinion.
Mm-hmm.
But...
And I hope I continue to have that freedom. And that's why I would not like to see them continue in the direction that they're going.
But you take away their freedom.
I'm not taking away their freedom. I'm saying that they are wrong in what they're desiring to do. When they say that, the only way that you can be a righteous person is to do it by their book, then that's wrong. My recollection of when I was going to school is the Constitution says there's a church and there's a state, and they shouldn't mess with each other. And if they do, then that's against the law, ain't it? Is that the way it goes? All right, when you have a president who has been elected with the assistance, very strong assistance, of fundamental religious groups who have put money and electronic technology behind his campaign to put him in there, they're shaking hands pretty good. And obviously now that he's in the White House, he has to help them out because they can cause him a lot of problems for his programs while he's in there. So it's a very dependent deal. The same way as the president is dependent on military and industrial organizations that have supported his regime. The thing that's bad about letting any kind of religious organization, whether it's fundamentalist, whether it's Jewish, whether it's Catholic, whether it's Hindu, whatever, to get involved in the business of controlling the secular life of the population, is that it's got to lead to the same kind of problems that you have in the Middle East.
The snouts and the driver's first, the loins and the groins are soon dispersed. His carving style is well rehearsed. He stands up, what does he say when he stands up and shouts?
Oh man!
Fuck this!
Say what?
That's what I thought he said. He stood up and he shouted. He said, hey, look at me. He said, oh man!
Say what? Get into it!
Oh man!
Say what?
He shouts, oh man, be cursed. Yeah, get this. And disagree. Well, no one dares. You know why? He's the best, of course, of all the worst.
He's the best, of course, of all the worst.
Some wrong been done, he done it first. And he stinks so bad, his bones been broken.
In his mouth, in the night of the iron sausage, where the torture never stops. The torture never stops. The torture. The torture. The torture never stops.
Your friend, I'm
we'll be right back.
I know you're very anti-drug, drugs of any kind.
Right.
How did that start?
Well, I was just never very enthusiastic about drugs or drug culture. And I saw what it had done to a lot of people, musicians that I've worked with, the ways that it affected their lives. I saw, well, since I've been touring for about 16 years, I've had a chance to watch the results of several different phases of popular chemical alteration on the audience as we play. You know, every once in a while a different drug goes on the charts, mm-hmm. and everybody uses it, and it affects the consciousness of the whole segment of the population.
Do you say anything to the audience about drugs during your show?
Oh, there's one or two songs that we do that are against drugs. We have one song called Cocaine Decisions, which talks about cocaine usage among lawyers, doctors, and movie people, mm-hmm. and what the net result of that is. But I don't give them a lecture on stage. A lot of times kids will try and hand me a joint, I just throw them away.
Mm-hmm. So you're against all drugs though, cocaine, marijuana,
yeah.
alcohol?
Well, I make a distinction with alcohol. I'm not a big drinker myself, but the thing about drugs is, being controlled substances with specific laws that put you in jail if you've got it, it makes you a criminal when you use it, you know, which gives the government another different type of leverage over you. If they catch you, they got that extra little zinger that they can use on mm-hmm. you, you know. It just puts your freedom in jeopardy, aside from what it does to your health and what it does to your mind. I believe the government likes to have drugs in the marketplace because it keeps the population in a very usable state.
You really believe there's some
yes.
sort of conspiracy?
Absolutely. There's no question in my mind that if you follow the pyramid right up to the top, that there's no difference between the people who are importing it and the people who are arresting you for using it.
What makes you feel that?
Does it sound far-fetched to talk about using an entire American community for chemical or biological warfare testing?
Not anymore. It doesn't sound far-fetched anymore.
Well, you know that it's been done. Our own government has decided to use certain American cities to test chemical warfare agents and biological warfare agents on American citizens without their knowledge. Just decided to do it because the time was right and the area was right, and they did it. And you only find out about it 10, 15 years later, okay? If the government can do that to their people, there's no reason to believe that they're above giving them drugs and collecting money for those drugs being used and having the benefit of the stupefaction of the population as a something thrown in along with it.
Except there are a lot of people who feel the same way you do, so they're not going to fall into that plan anyway, if indeed your plan would be correct.
Let me tell you something. I get asked about drugs so many times. Most times when I do an interview, they always ask me about drugs. And the reason they do is because I'm such an anachronism. I'm probably the last person in the United States who doesn't like them and doesn't use them. I mean, you know, maybe you're a person who doesn't use them. I don't know. I just don't enjoy them, and I don't like what they do to people.
I think there are a lot of people, though, that feel the same way you do. I mean that sincerely.
They're definitely the minority, because today, doctors get wasted. You know, they go out and snort cocaine before they do open-heart surgery.
Chop a line now. Cocaine decision. You are a person with a snow job. You got a fancy, got a go job. Where the cocaine decision that you make today will mean a million somewhere else. We'll do it your way. Cocaine decision. You are a person who is high class. You are a person not in my class. And the cocaine decision that you make today will mean nothing later on when you get nose decay. I don't wanna know about the things that you pull out of your nose or where they go. But if you are wasted from the stuff you're sticking in, and I get madder every day. That's what you do and what you say. Makes my life in such a way. I learned to hate it every minute. Aye, 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 aye.
You are a doctor or a lawyer. You've got an office with a foyer. Well, the cocaine decision that you made today may be discovered till it's over and done by the customers you hold at bay. Cocaine decisions. You are a booty business guy. You have a captain to supply the necessary figures to determine when you fly to Acapulco. Where all your friends go.
Awesome, come here. Yeah, bring the band on down behind me, boys.
Ragazzi, per favore, Zappa vorrebbe dirvi di stare calmi, di non gettare niente nello stadio e di non avere problemi con la polizia. Cercate di stare calmi. Non sappiamo esattamente cosa sta succedendo, però cercate di mantenere la calma, così si può andare avanti con lo spettacolo.
Now listen, we want to continue the concert. We want to keep playing music. Will you please be calm, sit down, and relax so we can play music? Sedute, per favore. Oh, tremendous. I've been passed a note. Here, I will read you this note. Says, dearest Frank Zappa, your music is great. Attitude towards women sucks. Raggedy Ann dances real well. Why not let her put some fucker in his place? Okay, signed, Margie. Well, let me tell you something about women's movement. There is only one good women's movement, and I'm deeply involved in it. That is the movement where their back arches up like this, and they hold on to the top of the bed, and their eyes roll back. This is the most important women's movement, and you should all be involved in it. Now, some other friendly advice. Do you know, the female species is divided into three compartments. There is the girl. A girl is a person who dreams of having a boy kiss her on the lips. Then you have the lady. The lady is a person who thinks every guy should kiss her ass. And then you have a woman who appreciates it when a man kisses her pussy. And that's how you tell them apart.
Oh. 60s was really stupid.
Okay, can you expand on that a little bit more? Why you think the 60s were really stupid?
Well, it was a type of merchandising. Americans have this hideous weakness, you know. They have this desire to be okay, fun guys and gals. And they haven't come to terms with the reality of the situation. We were not created equal. Some people can do carpentry. Some people can do mathematics. Some people are brain surgeons, and some people are winos, and that's the way it is. And we're not all the same. And this concept of one worldism, everything blended and smoothed out to this mediocre norm that everybody downgrades themselves to be, is stupid. And the 60s was merchandised to the public at large. My pet theory about the 60s is there's a sinister plot behind it, but I don't want to dwell upon that.
Okay.
It's just that the lessons learned in the 60s about merchandising stupidity to the American public on a large scale have been used over and over again since that time.
Thank you.
Do you consider yourself a religious person?
Absolutely.
And how do you show that within your life? I mean,
it's not a matter of showing it to anybody. I don't think that by showing your religious beliefs to anybody that makes you a religious person.
And how do you live it?
I live it through my music, and I live it through the way that I conduct my business.
Thank you.